So Teachers Day celebrated for whom? Radhakrishnan, right? So many people argue that perhaps we're going to talk about Savitribai Phule. Many people argue that her contribution to the field of promoting education was perhaps more than that of Radhakrishnan. And being the first woman to establish a school for women education. She was one of the foremost anti-caste reformers also, and also for the purpose of women education. So that one must celebrate Teachers Day in her memory. Now, basically, when we talk about, we were talking about the revolt of 1857 yesterday. Now, we talked about the causes, and apart from the causes, we have also, let's first talk about the impact, and then we can write down about the nature of the revolt also. Okay, so about the impact we're talking first. In terms of impact, one of the first things you need to know that every sensible government, including the British government, was trying to look into the revolt of 18. Every government looks into any major security lapse or any major war, etc., or any security lapse which triggered a revolt, into learning lessons from it. What could be learned? What lessons could be learned? For example, after every war, India also appoints a committee which looks into the lessons that can be learned from the war. Or, for example, after the 1999 Kargil war, the government appointed a high review committee, the Kargil Review Committee, the KRC as it is called, and it gave a number of findings and recommendations to explain the intelligence failures also and what lessons can be drawn from it. And after the 2008, the Mumbai attack, also the government appointed a committee to look into the lapses in coastal security and what lessons can be learned from it, so that similar mistakes can be avoided in the future. So after every prelims examination, you must also appoint your committee, okay, and then look into it. Okay, what can you learn from your success as well as your failures? Now, in terms of this, the British also looked into what lessons could be learned to ensure that similar revolts do not break out in the future. And this is not at all difficult to understand. The first thing that they said was that this policy of annexation has caused us too much trouble. Because this policy of annexation has disturbed the peace between the British and the Indian princely states. And this balance needs to be restored. And to that extent, they explicitly gave the promise that after the revolt of 1857, they gave an explicit assurance that no further annexation would be carried out, provided these states recognize their subordination to the crown. These states recognize that they are no more independent rulers, rather they are subordinate to the British crown, and they will continue with their privileges, etc., but as agents of the British crown. Because in subsidiary alliance, they would rule in their own name. Now they are saying that you recognize your subordination to the crown, and as you recognize your subordination to the crown, you will continue to rule with your perks and privileges, but as agents of the British crown. We will not annex you. That is our part of the bargain. But you also have to realize that it is that you are ruling at the mercy of the British. It is because the government has chosen you to be its representatives. That is why you are ruling, you are ruling because of the consent of the British and as their junior partners. That is what. So the principle of subordination, you have to recognize that you are subordinate to the British crown. Is that point clear? So this is something that they are emphasizing, that no further annexation would be done provided the princely states recognized their subordination. Okay? And this is being explicitly provided. So this is one thing. Okay. So one, this is the first thing, that they're changing their policy with respect to the princely states. The second important change they said was that the revolt of 1857 was triggered primarily because of the fact that the British are doing, that the East India Company has actually done what? The East India Company has mismanaged the Indian affairs. They said that such a revolt, such a major outbreak is happening, neither the British were able to predict it, neither the East India Company was able to predict it, nor do anything to prevent or to ensure its early resolution. Rather, it took a form of a large-scale conflict. It is why? Because the British have adopted a series of policies with a negative effect. Okay, and this, when they say British, they actually mean the East India Company. See, one thing has to be understood. If you remember, we were discussing the Charter Acts and the Administrative Act. Basically, what is happening through the Administrative Acts and Charter Acts? Slowly, the autonomy of East India Company is getting eroded, and the British Crown is slowly increasing its influence. The British Crown is slowly increasing its influence, and the East India Company's autonomy is getting eroded. Right? That point is there. So, now when there is such a major lapse, they argue that this is a sign that the East India Company is not able to manage the affairs effectively. Rather, it is the mismanagement of East India Company which has resulted in such a big problem. So, what should be done? Nationalize the East India Company. Ensure that it enjoys no longer any privilege in the region, because its actions have been the reason of the revolt of 1857. And as a result of this, the East India Company has mismanaged the affairs. So, the government control must be, or the Crown's control must be increased. And so, they introduced the Government of India Act 1858. Under the Government of India Act 1858, they said a couple of things. First, under the Government of India Act 1858, a couple of things were said. Firstly, they said that from now on, the Crown would take over the explicit responsibility. See, before 1858 also the Crown is taking over, the British Crown is taking over responsibilities, but indirectly. On the paper, on a number of places, East India Company enjoyed monopoly, trading rights, etc. All of that, they say, ki bhai, all of that has to come to an end. Now, this area will be directly administered by the British Crown with no role for the East India Company. Okay? The East India Company can continue doing trade, but for all practical purposes, administration, revenue collection, army, there will be no say of the East India Company. Okay? And basically, the Crown will take over the responsibility. A Secretary of State for Indian Affairs was appointed, a separate Secretary of State for Indian Affairs was appointed, who will, basically what would happen now is that the Governor General in India would report to whom? The Secretary of State. Okay, and the Secretary of State basically will be the agent of the British Crown. So, the Crown will be responsible for, the Crown will administer the area, the Secretary of State would be located, please wait, if I am telling you, aap logon ko ek cheez samajhni padegi, are yaar, have I finished? If I am not finished, I will give you time na, you can always ask, but don't interrupt. In Lakshmikant, what is given, I will come to. What is not given in Lakshmikant? That's not my concern. You first understand what I'm trying to say. So, the Secretary of State is responsible for Indian affairs and is based in London. Okay. And to him, ultimately, the Governor General is going to report about the Indian affairs. Now, the Governor General of India, through the Secretary of State, is reporting to the British Crown. At the same point of time, there was another position that was introduced, and that was the position of the Viceroy. Now, the position of the Viceroy and Governor General of India were actually different positions. these were actually different positions, and though these were different positions, one has to understand that they were given to the same individual. Viceroy was the authority who will deal on behalf of the crown with princely states. And the Governor General of India was responsible for the areas under direct administration of British, because British India now was in dual two major structures. One directly administered by British, like Bengal, like Hyderabad or Madras region or Bombay region. These areas were being directly administered by British. But in many other regions where they are saying that they will no further annex Indian states, to deal with them, the position that was appointed was that of the Viceroy. So technically there were to be two different offices, one of the Viceroy and the other of the Governor General of India. However, to ensure that there is no friction, that Viceroy says something else and Governor General says something else, these both offices were given to the same individual. Okay, so that there is no government of India, there is no separate policy of the crown towards the princely state. The Viceroy is saying something else and the Governor General is saying something else. There is no confusion, there is no absence of coordination. Rather, there is coordination. Both are given to the same individual. That is why, for example, you look at even India today, often similar ministries are either headed by the same individual which are expected to have a lot of convergence. For example, the Ministry of Overseas and Indian Affairs and the Ministry of External Affairs, both basically have one common objective, and that is to ensure the welfare of the Indian diaspora working elsewhere. Wo kaise hoga? It will happen how? It will happen if one way of ensuring is that both ministries speak in the same voice, and one way of ensuring that is that Sushma Swaraj heads both of them. Okay. This point. Dono ka function hai that those who will deal with the princely states on behalf of the British crown, their title will be the Viceroy. Okay, so it's a vice president of the royalty. So the British crown will deal with the royalty of other through the office of the Viceroy. When the British crown is dealing with areas directly administered by the British Indian government, they will be dealing through the office of the Governor General. Is this point clear? So often in a number of places, in books, etc., you'll find interchangeable. Koi bolega ki government, after the Government of India Act 1858, the people who were appointed were known as the Viceroys. Yes, that is true, but they are Governor General and Viceroy both. Kahin pe likha rahega Governor General, kahin pe likha rahega he was the Governor General and the first Viceroy. Because those who were getting appointed after 1858 are the first Viceroy. Okay. So this is something, what they're doing is a few changes like this. So in terms of the East India Company, some mismanagement, they said that now with the Secretary of State's office and through the offices of Governor General of India, basically we'll maintain a direct watch over the affairs in India, and all key appointments etc. will be also made through these offices. Okay. What about the role of the company? What about the role of the directors of the company? So the role of the directors of the company were, powers of the directors of the company to make key appointments are taken away. Anyways, major appointments are now being thrown open to civil services, right? Thrown open to a competitive exam after 1853. So basically a large amount of powers were being curtailed. The East India Company's predominant influence in the region is now being subordinated to the crown. Yeah, any doubts in these two points?
Secretary of State is the representative of British Crown.
parliament. So the Secretary of State is in a way to have the Secretary of State reports to the Crown, but is also, when he is reporting to the Crown does not enjoy any absolute monarchy. It is a constitutional monarchy. So given that it is a constitutional monarchy, the Crown has to be reported to, but the Secretary of State was a member of the British Parliament essentially, because reporting to the Crown was also partly reporting to the Parliament. Right? So, because it is a constitutional monarchy, not an absolute monarchy. In the absolute monarchy, there is no role for the parliament. But in a constitutional monarchy like, in a constitutional monarchy like Britain, they are responding to the parliament because why? The king itself, the powers of the king is defined by the constitution. And the constitution is also setting up the constitution is also setting up the parliament. Right? So that is why the Secretary of State was a member of the British Parliament, but he is the agent of the British Crown. That is that. Right? Just like you say that an individual is appointed by the President on, by the individual is appointed to so and so position by the President on the advice of the Council of Ministers. So similarly, he is appointed as the agent of the British Crown and is a member of the British Parliament, who is appointed also on the advice of the British Parliament. Anything else? So you are asking who is appointing the Governor General? Unko appoint kaise kiya? नहीं तो basically okay, I'll tell you this. Those people who are getting appointed as viceroys or governor generals, etc., they are not Indians. They are British individuals. Their appointment is being done through the Secretary of State now, after 1858. Uske pehle the appointment is being done in consensus, in talks between the British Parliament and the... Dekhiye, maine aapko ye bataya tha ki... Before Pitt's India Act, kya kar raha hai? That the Act of 1784 is doing what? Is introducing two things, Board of Control and the Board of Directors. Board of Directors were there before also. Right? The Board of Directors were that of the East India Company. Before 1857, how the governor is being appointed is the Board of Control has the final say. And the Board of Control has the final say in appointment of the Governor General, but it also takes the advice of the Board of Directors. So, Board of Directors represents the voice of the East India Company, and Board of Control represents the voice of the British Parliament. That is how it is being done. Now, after 1857, bol rahe hain ki ye inka koi role nahi hai appointment mein. Final, ab isko koi zarurat nahi hai to consult anybody else. There is no such role for the Board of Directors. Is that clear?
Board of Control is the Secretary of State.
Dekhiye, Board of Control, basically, so Board of Control is the voice of the government, right? Ultimately, when a separate Secretary of State gets appointed, he is the chairman of the Board of Control. Okay, so he is the chairman of the appointing committee, is the Secretary of State. Secretary of State here still has the Board of Control. He is like the chairman of the Board of Control. Okay. So, the Board of Control, whose chairman is the Secretary of State, is being appointed by the British Parliament, and has the final say on the appointment of the Governor General or the Viceroy. Clear? नहीं, सेक्रेटरी ऑफ द स्टेट का जो ऑफिस है, दोज द बोर्ड ऑफ कंट्रोल वॉज अपॉइंटेड इवन बिफोर 1858. नाउ दे आर सेइंग कि दो द इंडिविजुअल हु इज गोइंग टू हेड द बोर्ड ऑफ कंट्रोल, उसके ऑफिस को हम सेक्रेटरी ऑफ स्टेट कहेंगे. दोज हु द इंडिविजुअल हु विल हेड द बोर्ड ऑफ कंट्रोल, हिज ऑफिस विल बी टर्म्ड एज द ऑफिस ऑफ द सेक्रेटरी ऑफ स्टेट. और आपको अगर अभी भी कंफ्यूजन हो रहा है थोड़ा बहुत, आई विल गेट अ स्मॉल हैंड आउट अपलोडेड, उसमें मैं आपको सब कुछ लिख के ही दे दूंगा कि आप इधर उधर आप कहीं भागने की जरूरत नहीं पड़ेगी. अभी क्लियर है ये?
सर,
नो एक और बात, कोई बात नहीं, क्लियर है तो हो जाएगा, कहाँ जाएगा? देखिए ये जो शब्द होते हैं ना डबल गवर्नमेंट, ये है हो रहा है अभी, आप क्या अबॉलिश हुआ क्या, आप रुक जाइए बस एक बार और देख लीजिए, फिर उसके बाद मैं आपको पूछ लीजिएगा आप फिर से जो पूछना है। सो बिफोर 1858, आफ्टर 1858, बोर्ड ऑफ कंट्रोल, बोर्ड ऑफ डायरेक्टर्स, बोर्ड ऑफ डायरेक्टर्स इज द वॉइस ऑफ द ईस्ट इंडिया कंपनी एंड दे आर रिपोर्टिंग टू द बोर्ड ऑफ कंट्रोल, दिस बोर्ड ऑफ कंट्रोल इज द वॉइस ऑफ द ब्रिटिश पार्लियामेंट, दिस बोर्ड ऑफ कंट्रोल एंड बोर्ड ऑफ डायरेक्टर्स टूगेदर आर डिटरमाइनिंग हु विल बी द गवर्नर जनरल, बट द फाइनल वर्ड इज टू बी टेकन बाय द बोर्ड ऑफ कंट्रोल। नाउ द लीडर, दो द इंडिविजुअल हु विल बी हेडिंग द बोर्ड ऑफ कंट्रोल, वॉट इज चेंजिंग आफ्टर 1858, फर्स्टली दिस रोल गोज, ओके, सो इट इज ओनली टू बी मेड बाय द बोर्ड ऑफ कंट्रोल, एंड द इंडिविजुअल हु विल हेड द बोर्ड ऑफ कंट्रोल इज हु इज बींग टर्म्ड एज द सेक्रेटरी ऑफ स्टेट फॉर इंडियन अफेयर्स। Now, what is to be understood that before 1858 also there were a Secretary of State, but that was not exclusively for Indian affairs, that was for all affairs. Now they are appointing a separate Secretary of State only for Indian affairs. Okay, is that point clear? That before this also they have Secretary of State position, but that is not for Indian affairs. Now, specifically Secretary of State for Indian affairs. Because the Secretary of State is now being appointed specifically for Indian affairs, who is in charge only of Indian affairs, because the British had colonies other places also. For other areas, they had different Secretary of States. For Indian affairs, they are appointing a separate Secretary of State. Abhi clear? Haan, London. He would stay in London. The Secretary of State would be stationed in London, and the Governor General would be stationed in, or Viceroy would be stationed in India. The Governor General, ऐसे समझ लीजिए, the government Governor General or the Viceroy is like the CEO, okay, who's in charge of the day-to-day administration, etc. And the Board of Directors, you know, is stationed there in London. Okay, the Board of Directors, Board of Control, everything is in London. Clear? अभी कोई और doubt? You are asking something? हाँ. Clear? हाँ. There's only one Governor General for the whole of the country. There were regional governors still for different provinces. These regional governors would report to the Governor General. The Governor General would report to the Secretary of State. Abhi clear? Everybody? पीछे? अरे बस अब रुक जाइए, इसके आगे आपको नहीं जाना है, कितने मेंबर थे, कितने उसमें से कौन अपॉइंट कर रहा है, वो हमारा काम नहीं है, हमारा बस इतना हमें पता होना चाहिए। फॉर एग्जाम्पल आई वाज टेलिंग यू कि 1784 में गवर्नर जनरल हैज एन एग्जीक्यूटिव काउंसिल ऑफ 3 मेंबर्स, राइट? इन 1784 द गवर्नर जनरल वाज हैविंग एन एग्जीक्यूटिव काउंसिल ऑफ 3 मेंबर्स, अब वो कितना एक्सपैंड हो रहा है, क्या हो रहा है, कोई रेलिवेंस नहीं हमारे एग्जाम के। कौन थे? बोर्ड ऑफ कंट्रोल, ओके, बोर्ड ऑफ कंट्रोल मेंबर आर द प्राइवेट डायरेक्टर्स ऑफ द ईस्ट इंडिया कंपनी, ओके, द बोर्ड ऑफ कंट्रोल मेंबर्स वुड ऑफन बी द would often be appointed by the British, including a large number of cabinet members or the British parliamentarians. That is what included the board of control. Board of control. ठीक है? यहाँ पे government officials हैं, यहाँ पे private players. ठीक है? Anything else? हो गया? Okay. Now, so these two things are happening. The third thing that is happening is कि कह रहे हैं कि ये सारा फसाद कहाँ चालू हुआ? Army. All the mess begins where? In the army, because they are revolting, etc. So, ye army ka kya problem hai? Isko sort out karte. They said that the problem of the army is what? That you have less European supervision. See, one thing is you can say, ki, aray, open up the higher positions to Indian soldiers, but that was unreliable. That was neither the objective or higher position ke liye to Britain mein hi competition hai. Right. So basically what they said was, for the army we need to change a few things. We need to bring about the Europeanization of the
आर्मी.
यूरोपियनाइजेशन ऑफ द आर्मी मतलब दे सेड कि प्रॉब्लम क्या है कि देर आर लेस यूरोपियन सोल्जर्स. देर इज वन यूरोपियन एंड देर आर थ्री इंडियन सोल्जर्स. दे सेड द रेशियो इज वेरी पुअर. देर इज लेस इफेक्टिव यूरोपियन सुपरविजन. द इंडियन सोल्जर्स क्लियरली आउटनंबर द यूरोपियन सीनियर्स. वी विल इंक्रीज दिस रेशियो फ्रॉम 1:3:2:3. सो देर वुड बी टू यूरोपियंस एंड देर वुड बी थ्री इंडियंस. विल इंक्रीज द रेशियो ऑफ. अब कितना परसेंटेज इंक्रीज है वो आप देख लीजिए जो भी है मुझे नहीं पता. 1:4:25%. 2/5 is 40%. So 15% increase. I am presuming. I don't know. And my maths is not that great. So agar ye sahi hai to ye. But 1:3:2:3. Okay. So that is the ratio which is. Firstly, they are increasing the ratio of European soldiers to Indian soldiers. Second, they said problem kya hai that we are recruiting more from Awadh region. Let's not recruit from Awadh region because it has shown too much political instability and sensitivity. Let's diversify away from Awadh region and recruit. And they said that we should recruit from areas which are less politically sensitive or less politically volatile. And those areas, the soldiers recruited from those areas which played a crucial role in suppressing the 1857 revolt, we should recruit more from these areas. And these included recruiting a larger number of soldiers from Sikh regions or from the Gorkha regions. They argued that the soldiers from this region are more brave, more loyal, more disciplined, or loyal or trustworthy. So that is what you require in whom? An ideal soldier? Has to be brave, has to be trustworthy, disciplined and loyal. So they said these soldiers are more, the soldiers from these regions have proved all of this. They are what they termed as the martial races. They said that the soldiers from these regions are more, have all of these qualities. They are martial races and thus we will recruit more from these regions. We will diversify away from Awadh and recruit more from regions like the Sikh region, the Gorkha region. Why? Because of two reasons. One, they said that these are martial races, thus worthy of being recruited. Secondly, if now there was an uprising, say in the Awadh region, it could be quickly used, suppressing the troops drawn from other regions. Or say if there was an uprising, say in the Madras region, then the troops recruited from other region could be used to suppress. Let's not depend on troop recruitment only from one region. Diversification of troop recruitment away from Awadh. Also, they said ki inka problem kya hai? They want display of caste symbols, religious symbols, etc. So basically they said that if we will do from now on what? Raise regiments and reorganize regiments along caste and reorganize regiments along what? Caste and regional identities, not religious, but actually caste and regional identities. So you have these terms, right? Like the Madras regiment, the Rajputana regiment, this regiment, that regiment, right? The Gorkha regiment. So basically around regional and caste identities, they said we will raise new regiments and where individuals belonging to one region or one caste are likely to be recruited. What will this do? This will prevent the emergence of a larger nationalism. If people remain, so the argument here goes that if firstly I raise a regiment, say the Madras regiment, it will be composed of soldiers recruited from this region. Now I can use the Madras regiment to crush a uprising in Awadh because these soldiers are likely to have more of regional loyalty. And also as people take more pride in their caste or regional identities, it will prevent the emergence of a larger national identity. And to that extent, allowing regiments to be laid along caste and regional lines will allow people to take more pride in these identities, which works or which is totally fine. Why? Because on the one side, it can be used in suppressing revolts in other areas. You can use the Gorkha regiment to suppress a revolt in Awadh, Awadh regiment to suppress a revolt in Madras, Madras regiment to suppress a revolt somewhere in Rajput, Rajput regiment somewhere else. And this will ensure what? That firstly, people take more pride in their regional and caste identities, and they will have less objections. And ultimately, they want to remain with, or they want that their caste restrictions must be observed. So even that would be observed and will prevent the emergence of a larger national identity. Dekhiye, ek cheez hai. Kendriya Vidyalayas are supposed to have an exchange program, right? After, I think, I don't remember for which classes? Navodaya. Yeah, 6 to, yeah, sorry, not Kendriya, Navodayas. Yeah, Navodayas have this concept, right? 8 to 10th, whatever the standard, that basically for a session, you will, suppose you are studying in a Navodaya Vidyalaya in Madhya Pradesh, you will probably go off to another, to the Navodaya Vidyalaya for an exchange to another region. What does this do? It tells you that you are living in a bubble. It tells you that you should probably foster a bigger or a better identity, which is more, you know, you get into interactions with students from different Navodaya Vidyalayas. You spend one semester or a year, I think. Okay. So this is this idea was fostered so that schools could become a vehicle of national integration. So if you have studied in a North Indian school all your life, you have never dealt with a student from with a classmate from Northeast. Yeah, so that is what basically the whole idea is, to foster integration in the sense that students get a classroom becomes a representative of a society. See, what is the problem with Indian schools and universities today? The status of a university, I would say, the more representative it is of a society, the better can the learning be. Often, when you go to the schools, you meet the people from the same region, the same language, and often the same caste groups also. And often from similar religions also. There is absolutely no diversity of viewpoints or people within the schools, and in universities also. It's not just schools, universities also. And this is something that ensured that you don't know about other people, about other cultures within your own country. And that is why you caught off guard when you were like, Ajay, ye kya hota hai? Types, right? So, this is something which is prevents the development of a larger national integration. That is why schools like Navodaya Vidyalaya and this whole scheme was envisioned in this idea. So having regiments now which were exclusively along caste or regional identity lines would prevent the emergence of a larger national identity. Right? Your classroom does not become a microzone of the nation in that way if you only have people from one region. But if you have people from various areas, etc., it can probably become, you know, a representative of a bigger national project. So that is why in some universities, etc., they have, you know, specific reservations for people from backward districts or backward regions, etc. That is primarily to ensure that the university is more representative. But this is missing here. Okay? And this is preventing the development of a larger national identity. This also, whole strategy of reorganizing the army along caste, regional lines, martial races idea is what is an example of divide and rule. Divide and rule is not merely dividing people along religious lines. Wo to ho sakta hai. But dividing people along the lines of any identity, which prevents the emergence of a larger national identity. That is divide and rule. Whether that is along caste lines, regional lines, religious lines, whatever. And which is a deliberate part of state policy. So we say it is a deliberate part of British policy to envision a reorganization of the army, which increases European control, at the same point of time reorganizes the army on the principles of divide and rule by fostering the development of regional and caste identities and regiments along these lines. Now, in post-independence India, though these regiments have continued, given their legacy, etc., though these names have continued, like the Madras Regiment, Rajput Regiment, etc., but that does not mean that they recruit soldiers only from that region. Rather, you can find the Madras Regiment, an individual from North India also, or vice versa, etc. So, but those names have continued. Okay. Pardon? So, basically, but the whole idea is that we do not have any reservation primarily on the whole idea that only people from one region will become a part of one regiment. That is what has been broken. Obviously, there is wo andar ka nuance kuch bhi ho. The basic idea is ki it is not that the Rajput regiment will only have Rajputs. That concept is no longer there. Though the names have largely continued. Is this much clear? So you can firstly write down this much, then we'll discuss further. You can write down the impact of revolt of 1857. The revolt of 1857 forced a reconsideration in British policy towards India this resulted in first point this resulted in first point the introduction of Government of India Act, the introduction of Government of India Act 1858, the introduction of Government of India Act 1858. Under the Act, the British Crown took up the direct administrative responsibilities by A. The appointment of a new Secretary of State. The appointment of a new Secretary of State for Indian Affairs, the appointment of a new Secretary of State for Indian Affairs to head the Board of Control. The Secretary of State, in the same point, right? The Secretary of State was to be a member of the British Parliament. The Secretary of State was to be a member of the British Parliament. A under the same point you write point B, right? We have written first is appointment, right, of the Secretary of State. The second point you write, a new office of the Viceroy was introduced which was to be in charge of maintaining relations with Indian princely states. The Viceroy's position The Viceroy's position was to be granted to the Governor General of India who was in charge of direct administration in British colonies. Who was in charge of direct administration in British colonies? Okay? That's one thing. Now, so moreover, in the same point, moreover, the Viceroy or the Governor General, now we are using the terms interchangeably, okay? Moreover, Viceroy or the Governor General was to report. Moreover, the Viceroy or the Governor General was to report to the Secretary of State. And the Secretary of State is also appointing the, you know, through the Secretary of State who is heading the Board of Control, the appointment of the Viceroy and the Governor General of India is happening. Theek hai? I hope that is clear. No more confusion than this. And iske alawa aur detail mein jaane ka zarurat nahi hai. Itna hi bahut. Now, the next thing to focus on, so that is one, then write the next point. So this is point number one, which has ended, the introduction of Government of India Act 1858. The second point we're writing, a reconsideration of policy with respect to princely states was done. In this point you write, the policy the policy of annexation introduced under Lord Dalhousie introduced under Lord Dalhousie 1850s onwards was done away with introduced 1850s onwards was done away with and the British and the British introduced the policy of subordination. The British introduced a policy of subordination under which under which the Indian princely states were expected to explicitly recognize their subordination to the British Crown and would be subjected to no further annexation. Right in the next para. In 1876, in 1876, the Queen adopted the title of Kaiser-e-Hind, or the Queen Empress of India, or the Kaiser-e-Hind, K-A-I-S-E-R, Kaiser-e-Hind, or the Empress of India, the Queen Empress of India. Because of this, so basically, you see, under the Government of India Act 1858, the Crown is assuming the responsibility. It is changing its position with respect to princely states. Princely states are no longer being annexed, but they are subordinated to the British Crown, and the Crown is assuming the formal, in a formal ceremony to basically, commemorate this fact. The Queen in 1876 came to India and basically assumed this position in a royal ceremony that was done in Delhi. Okay, that is why. So this is a reflection of point number 1 and 2, both of them. Yeah. Princely states are getting to keep their principalities, getting to keep their privileges. They are more than happy. The princely states after this said that we love the British Empire. We want to be a part of it. And we want the British Empire to continue in perpetuity, so that our rule also continues in perpetuity. Yeah.
Why is this act was known as Good Government Act?
Good, who is calling it Good Government Act? Good government. So they are saying now that we will do what the Government of India Act 1858. So they are basically saying that ultimately now the British Crown is saying that it's the same idea of the white man's burden, that we are here for your benefit. We are going to rule you for your benefit. We are going to bring good governance, vikas. Right. So it's gonna come to you. One of these days it is going to come to you. So good government is there. So we are taking up the direct responsibility, and we'll bring, there's nothing else that we can think of in terms of any significance. Anything else? Clear? So please write down further. Third point about no government comes, and okay, this is one point that has provoked me to say this, that no, there's a point which is a valid point, and Bipin Chandra also writes this. Okay. In the he doesn't write this in the small book that you read. I mean, in India, Struggle Till Independence, in the introduction, he writes this. And he says, and this is a predominantly jo political science mein padhte hain, padhate hain, and that is about what? That is about hegemony. That basically, it's not soft power or anything. Wo IR wala hegemony nahi hai. We are saying neo-Marxism wala hegemony, in which Antonio Gramsci says that every ruler rules with two things, with partly with the use of force and partly with the use of consent. Okay, and no ruler rules with only one of them. The question is how much you are ruling with force and how much you are ruling with consent. And that is why you have such terms. There, the rule of the ruling class is impossible unless the subject class believes, at least to a considerable degree, that the rule of the ruling class is good for them. It is impossible for the rule to of the ruling class to continue unless the subject class buys this explanation that the rule is worth, or the rule is something that will lead to the betterment of lives for them. So it's not that the, and this is a common misconception that we argue, are ye to obvious si baat thi ki British rule is, the British rule is a source of distress or is a source of exploitation and it must be overthrown. We today assume that there is a consensus. There was always a consensus. There was never a consensus, especially till the 1900s. There is never a consensus. See, one of the things has to be seen. If the British are introducing railways, if the British are introducing higher education institutions, what is being done before the British? Zilch. Zero. Right. So the British had also to show something. That we are building railways, we are building medical hospitals, we are building universities, we are building schools, we are doing higher education. We anyways are responsible for, you know, giving you jobs in the army, in government offices. So it's not that for an individual in the 19th century, British rule was always evil that had to be overthrown or there was some remarkable consensus. If a history of this period is written 200 years later, then probably people will say, it was very clear that these policies were not working, or the 21st century saw a rise in unemployment. But for you today, you may not think that you are looking at historically high unemployment levels. We are looking at. The problem today with India is that India has mastered one thing, the art of not collecting data. We have mastered this not just today. It's not an event of aaj ka, kal ka, ya pichle 4 saal ka. It is an event of systematic not collection of data for almost a decade and a half now. For example, India, if you would have read in the newspapers a couple of years ago, Sri Lanka reported that we have eliminated malaria. India stopped reporting only. So it's already eliminated. The Lancet published a paper that India has underreported its TB burden by almost 2/3. हमें डेटा ही कलेक्ट करना बंद कर दो, अपने आप प्रॉब्लम खत्म. राइट, एंड इफ यू डोंट हैव अ अथॉरिटेटिव स्टेट कलेक्शन ऑफ डेटा, देन इट इज वेरी डिफिकल्ट टू अराइव एट अ कंक्लूजन वेदर ग्रोथ इज हैपनिंग और नॉट, वेदर एम्प्लॉयमेंट इज हैपनिंग और नॉट. ओके, एंड दैट इज व्हाई यू हैव वन डेटा सेइंग समथिंग एल्स, अदर डेटा इज सेइंग समथिंग एल्स, वेयर प्रोबेबली बोथ शुड बी पॉइंटिंग इन द सेम डायरेक्शन. इफ यू हैव इंडेक्स ऑफ इंडस्ट्रियल प्रोडक्शन इज नॉट इंक्रीजिंग बट जीडीपी इज इंक्रीजिंग, how is that possible? Okay, or there is some problem. Now, I'm not an economist worth my salt that I can actually go and understand all of that. This can be understood only by an economist. Okay, so, but there is clearly, if facts do not point in one direction, then probably there is something that is fishy. The Prime Minister has been repeatedly saying that, for example, formal employment in India has increased under the, because the Employees Provident Fund, EPFO, registrations have increased. But what does that exactly mean? That requires to be, you know, deciphered more. So it's not, but this is something that every ruler has to do with, is consent of the ruling class, of the subject class. Without the consent of the subject class, rule is not possible. So the British also often threw up symbols, evoked actions, and cited justification that British rule is good for Indians. And they often evoked the history of a past where they said that India is a backward, civilized, uncivilized, barbaric society. We are bringing you civilization. That is it. Now, let's come and write the third point. Army. The role of the army. the reorganization of the army. Third point. Princely states, we've written, Government of India Act, we have written, the third point is about the army, the reorganization of the army. The army, which became the nerve center, the army which became the nerve center of the revolt was to be reorganized. The army which became the nerve center of the revolt was to be reorganized, to tighten the British control. By introducing a series of changes. And now within this you write point A. The Europeanization of the army, was to be carried out to increase what? The Europeanization of the army was to be carried out to increase the supervision of Indian sepoys. SEPOY, sepoys. For example, from the earlier ratio of 1:3, in the bracket you write European is to Indian. European is to Indian soldier. Close the bracket. The ratio was increased to 2:3. Point number B. The army regiments were to be reorganized along the lines of caste and regional identities. For example, the Rajputana regiment. Or the Sikh regiment. Were introduced. Point number C. The conception of martial races RACES the conception of martial races was introduced to diversify the recruitment away from the Awadh region to recruit more from the Sikh and Gorkha regions, which played a critical role in suppressing the revolt. The British argued that these races were more brave, loyal and disciplined and thus worthy of being recruited within the army. Okay. So you can write. The Gorkha regiment included soldiers from the Gorkha region, which includes today's Nepal. Okay. And this is one of the aspects of colonial legacy, that a large number of soldiers during the British era were recruited from the Gorkha region, okay, from the regions of Nepal. And even independent India continues to recruit a large number of soldiers from the Gorkha regions. Okay. And that continues even today. Independent India has a large number of soldiers which are recruited from the Gorkha regions of modern day Nepal, who are Nepali citizens but serve in the Indian army. And it's not the only example in the world. You have Israeli citizens who serve in the US army. Okay. So that is there. Okay. Now, so what were we saying? Okay. So just last one more point here. Thus, the reorganization of the army after 1857, was a part of the divide and rule. Thus, the reorganization of army after 1857 was a part of divide and rule strategy of the was a part of the divide and rule strategy of the British. Was a part of the divide and rule strategy of the British. Okay, that is the point. And मैंने आपको बताया divide and rule strategy is this, which is to keep people wedded to their caste identities, regional identities, religious identities, which prevents the emergence of a larger national identity, which could pose a threat to British rule. And that is the divide and rule policy. I hope that is clear, right? So one last thing, one or two more points. For example, with respect to socio-religious leaders, they said, what is their problem? They want us not to introduce any social reforms, so we'll not introduce. What is the big deal? So they said that from now on, we are not going to interfere in the religious and social affairs of Indians, largely. And thus, after this period, the British largely gave up their policy of introducing social legislative or social reforms through bringing in new laws or legislations. Okay. Then they said, okay, apart from this, then one large dissatisfied section of the population was also whom? Peasantry ko unhone bola inko tum dekh lenge. Because ultimately, if you start lowering the burden of taxation on the peasantry, then why on earth are the British here to rule? Ultimately, the British are here for their economic gain. So there is not that the British are lowering any tax rates, etc. But when we'll see peasant struggles, we'll see that the British granted them concessions from time to time. Okay, so some concessions were granted from time to time for a year. Jaise aapne picture dekhi Lagan. Right, so in Lagan, if you carefully watch the movie, is not saying that after you lose the match, you will withdraw from the region. The peasant is also, they are saying that for this session, for this year, etc., will not pay taxes. They are not saying that we will not pay taxes at all. They are only saying that we will not pay it for this year. Right. So, often the British did grant concessions from time to time to peasants, but there is no long-term solution to the problems of the peasants. That is why peasant revolts happened before 1857 also and after 1857. That is that. But by bringing about, and this was the question asked in the main examination, that the revolt of 1857 marked a watershed in the politics of, in the colonial policies in 19th century India. So what is that watershed? Is that they are changing whatever things we wrote for the Government of India Act 1858, or the change in policy with respect to princely states, or the change in policies with respect to army, or with respect to social reforms. That is all the change. But largely with respect to the peasantry, the position remained unchanged. That is there. But then why is there no other big armed revolt like this? Is because the British are tightening their control over the army and developing more friendly relations with princely rulers. So what is going to happen? They are the ones who are providing leadership in the revolt of 1857. That is why just keep the leadership in good friendly mood, and the other masses could be ignored. That is what was the British strategy. Okay. So that is why when Congress is emerging and is taking over the leadership, that is again, you know. So in a way, it is actually the leadership which probably, you know, was a key driving factor. Before, till 1857, there is no nationalist leadership like that of the Congress. After 1900s, there is a new leadership emerging. That is what we are going to study next. Okay. So, you can write the next point. One more thing. With respect to Muslims, and this is also there, that Bahadur Shah Zafar was the emperor. And Bahadur Shah Zafar, it was under the banner of the Mughal Empire that the revolt happened. Also, a number of soldiers who revolted were Muslims. So, to that extent, the British argued that the British followed after 1857 a policy of discrimination against Muslims in recruitment, whether in army or in administration in general, arguing that they are untrustworthy and disloyal. And so, a policy of discrimination was followed, and from 1850s to 1870s and 80s, for the next 20 or 30 years, there was an active discrimination that was witnessed against Muslims in recruitment and government jobs and within the army, as they were held as one of the key instigators of the revolt. So you can write down. Point number four, with respect to social issues, the British explicitly offered a policy of non-interference. In religious affairs of caste Hindus and Muslims. And largely refrained from introducing any further legislative reforms. In the next para, you write within the same point, moreover, a discriminatory policy against further recruitment of Muslims in administration, against recruitment of Muslims in administration and army was adopted. As the revolt was launched under a British, under a Mughal banner. Now, basically, that is there. Finally, we are just writing one more thing, and that is about the nature of the revolt. Okay. So, in the nature of the revolt, you write with me. I've already discussed all these points with you. You can write with me, and then we'll move to the next topic. Okay. Okay, one more thing that I'm just telling you is that the Indian middle class is not very supportive of the revolt of 1857, because they argued that ultimately it is going to be a return to the same backward structure that was there under the pre-British India. Okay, so they're not really supportive of the overthrow of British at this time. So when we talk about the revolt of 1857, to what extent basically it can be termed as two things. The first national war of independence, that is one thing, we'll write about that. And secondly, two questions are to be answered here. To what extent it is the first national war of independence? Aisa ek question puch sakte hain, or they can ask you the question that to what extent the revolt of 1850, they can give you a question like this, that the revolt of 1857 was more than a mutiny but less than a revolt. Okay, so why do we say, some people say that it is merely, for example, the British argue that what is mutiny? Mutiny is an act of indiscipline. Mutiny is an act of indiscipline or disobedience within the army. Now, the mutiny is a term which is often given to firstly say that it is only, basically, many a number of historians argued that the incidents of 1857 was actually a mutiny of the army, mutiny within the army. A mutiny is something which is often termed as what? Something restricted to the army and a result of disobedience or insubordination within the army. So it is argued, many a number of Cambridge historians actually argue that revolt of 1857 was nothing, it was merely a mutiny, basically a result of indiscipline and insubordination within the army. But a number of other Indian historians argue that this is not the case, because if it was merely to be a mutiny of the army, then a wider section of Indian society would not have been involved, right? If it was only about the army, then the peasants would not have joined, the zamindars would not have joined, the princely rulers would not have joined. So the fact that the movement soon spread beyond the army to include other sections of the Indian society meant what? That it was a wider revolt, not merely a mutiny. And that it represented what? It represented the underlying discontent with the British rule. That is why the movement is soon spreading from the army to include other sections of the Indian society also. If it would have been only about the grievances of the army or unaddressed issues within the army, it would not have involved other sections of the Indian society. Okay, that is also one major point about the nature of the revolt, that it has a relatively larger mass base and represented the discontent within different sections of the society, not merely the army, as is argued by some historians who argue that it is merely a mutiny. Okay, is that point clear? So you can just quickly write about the revolt of 1857, the nature of revolt of 1857. Here basically there are, firstly we are writing about this point. V.D. Savarkar in his book on V.D. Savarkar in his book on the revolt of 1857 argued that this was the first war of what? Independence. That this was the first war of independence. First national war of independence. However, other historians have pointed out the limited regional spread of the revolt primarily to north and central India. The limited regional spread of the revolt primarily to north and central India. The limited regional spread of the revolt primarily to north and central India. Rather than having a pan Indian spread, and thus have questioned its questioned its spread, etc., right? Point number B. North and, okay, where you've written predominantly North and Central India, just write in bracket Awadh, right? Primarily North and Central India, including areas of Awadh, Bihar, etc. Okay. Point number B. The revolt aimed to overthrow. The revolt aimed to overthrow the British rule from the region. The revolt aimed to overthrow the British rule from the region and re-establish princely rule, or re-establish the rule of princely states, one and the same thing. Re-establish princely rule or re-establish rule of princely states. Thus, despite its anti-imperial objective, Thus, despite its anti-imperial objectives, the revolt had no agenda, to politically empower the masses. So we've said one of the things, lack of any progressive cohesive ideology, all those things. So yes. So these are the reasons for failure also. I mean, regional spread and all the things we had told before also, right? So, and point number C. The movement was not the first arm, was the movement was not the first armed revolt. The movement was not the first armed revolt against the British in India, as a number of tribal revolts before 1857. For example, the Santhal uprising of 1850s had aimed to achieve similar objectives and aim to achieve similar objectives. Next para, within the same. Okay, next para within the same. Despite its shortcomings, the revolt or the movement, basically, the revolt or the movement represented the first coordinated armed revolt to overthrow the British rule from India and even in failure continued to inspire the future generations of the nationalist struggle to finish the objective or to achieve the objective that would be better to achieve the objective of the revolt of 1857. Clear? Now, this, what about the other thing and about what? The revolt of 1857, basically, is it, or the uprising of 1857, whether it is a mutiny or a revolt? You can give the heading, uprising of 1857, mutiny or revolt. This is the conclusion from Bipin Chandra. Sir, that even in failure it served a grand purpose, continued to inspire the future generation. So that is what is the conclusion. That even if the question comes, is it the first national war of independence or not? You point out its weaknesses and then say that even in failure, it continued to inspire the future generations of struggle. Though critics have argued about its national character, or whether it was a war for independence, or whether it was the first war or not also. Clear? So you can give the next heading. Sorry.
Sir, in this year, there was a news that the Paika rebellion of
1857. It's the first national war. Okay, so, jo koi ek minister, koi, it's ultimately, this is also first revolt of 1857. Who is the final authority to say this? जब हो जाएगा तब देखी जाएगी और वैसे भी अभी हुआ नहीं है और दूसरा यह है कि बीडी सावरकर इज सेइंग कि अकॉर्डिंग टू हिम इट इज द फर्स्ट वॉर ऑफ इंडिपेंडेंस इफ यू आर अ संतल यू विल से दैट आई ट्रेस माय हिस्ट्री नॉट टू द रिवोल्ट ऑफ 1857 आई एम अ संतल आई ट्रेस माय हिस्ट्री टू द संतल रेबेलियन टू मी दैट इज द फर्स्ट वॉर ऑफ इंडिपेंडेंस राइट सो इट इज आई मीन दिस इज द डिफरेंस बिटवीन फिजिक्स केमिस्ट्री एंड हिस्ट्री वी इज इक्वल टू यू प्लस एटी इज नॉट अ मैटर ऑफ ओपिनियन Right, or V is equal to UT plus half AT square is not a matter of opinion. It is a statement of fact. Force equal to mass into acceleration does not change without whether BJP comes in power or Congress. Right, or you have Hindu state or you have Muslim state. Force remains mass into acceleration. But these things can, is a matter of interpretation. So that is why we are just, so I mean, there is no sentimental, to me there is no sentimental value attached that this is the first national war of independence. Aisa kuch nahi hai, to mahol sa jane wali baat. That is that. Now, so the next thing to write is the uprising of 1857, mutiny or revolt. Okay, just give the heading, the uprising of 1857, mutiny or revolt. Within this, you write, the uprising of 1857, the uprising of 1857 is not merely a mutiny. As suggested by Cambridge historians, who argue that the uprising was an outcome, that the uprising was an outcome of indiscipline or insubordination within, outcome of indiscipline or insubordination within the army. Next para. Indian historians have argued that the revolt was an outcome, or that the uprising was an outcome of the wider discontent. The uprising was an outcome of the wider discontent The uprising was an outcome of the wider discontent that had emerged against the wider discontent that had emerged against British rule of the wider discontent that had emerged against British rule and thus wider discontent that had emerged against British rule and thus saw the participation of different social classes, and thus saw the participation of different social classes such as and thus saw the participation of different social classes such as whom? Such as peasants or peasantry princely rulers such as peasantry, princely rulers, zamindars, and the army. And the army itself. So basically, so the argument of Indian historians been what? That if you term it merely as a mutiny, it seems that it is nothing more than an act of indiscipline within the army. But when you say that it is a revolt, it is, you know, a revolt against the policies of the British. Is that point clear? Now, the next thing that we are talking about, rather than peasants, because I think that would be a bit boring for now, let's start with social reforms. Peasant issues bhi padhna hai, peasant and tribal issues we'll also discuss. Then start with social reforms, also a very big topic and a very important one also. Okay. Social reforms pe prelims or mains dono mein kafi questions have been asked in the past. For example, last, not this year, not 2017 mains examination, but 2016 mains examination, they asked a question that discussed the role of 18th century social reform movements with respect to improvement of position of women. Okay. In your prelims examination, repeatedly from this area questions are asked. What kind of questions? Either questions partly of factual nature, what was this organization working, which issues this organization was working on, or who formed this organization? Okay, these kind of factual questions. Or they'll give, for example, that which of the following issues were picked up by the Brahmo Samaj, or by the Arya Samaj, or by the Young Bengal movement, or who, which of the following individuals were associated with the Brahmo Samaj. So these kind of questions, factual questions are also asked, and analytical questions are also asked. What kind of, I'll keep telling you. So firstly, when we're talking about social reform movements, dekhe, we are going to talk about the two broad categories in which we categorize social reform movements. One are the reformists and the other are the revivalists. But reformists and revivalists is one thing. The other thing that they ask you questions about is about key organizations and their objectives. And the two big issues that we deal here are the issues related to women and caste. Okay. Also, they can ask you questions in the mains examination to compare and discuss the evolution of Indian social reform movements over 19th and 20th century. Because Shekhar Bandyopadhyay writes extensively about social reform movements in India and argues that there is a very important difference, or there are major differences in the way social reform movements happened in 19th century and the way they happened in 20th century. So they can ask you a direct comparative question on this. Compare the national movements of 19th, social reform movements of 19th century and 20th century. Okay. So that kind of a question can also be asked from here. And what are we going to do? We are going to first talk about the reformists and revivalists by taking examples of key organizations. Then apart from this, there are some other organizations, individuals, which cannot be strictly termed reformist or revivalist. You have people like Vivekanand, etc. So we'll talk about some of those individuals also. And there are some 8-10 organizations that I'll talk about. Okay, 8-10 organizations, who formed them, what were their objectives, etc. That is something that we'll discuss. Okay, one thing more to go forward. I increasingly find students coming to me and asking me one question, not just from you, but overall. Aur bhi main jo bhi padhata hu sab mein. Ki, sir, if we do class notes, is it enough? Right. Ek cheez jeevan mein, jo aapko ye sawal ka ye jawab de raha hai, ki just do class notes and it's enough. Wo aapko is being dishonest with you, and you are also being dishonest with yourself इफ यू एक्सपेक्ट दिस, आपकी एक्सपेक्टेशन में ही स्ट्रक्चरल प्रॉब्लम है कि मैं एक कॉपी में क्लास में आऊंगा, उसमें मैं लिखूंगा, इस कॉपी को मैं पढ़ूंगा, इस कॉपी से मैं आईएएस बन जाऊंगा. ऐसा कुछ नहीं होने वाला है. There is nothing of this sort which is going to happen. And anybody who makes a claim like this is like Ramdev, who was telling you that 15 lakhs is going to come to your account. That did not come. It came to Ramdev's account. Okay. So, do not believe in such ideas. But one should understand that there are certain, what should be your approach of coming to the class is what you could have done in 60 hours. You can probably do it in 30 here. You can learn, okay, these things are important, these things what I am focusing on more. This is how I am going to write the answer. That does not mean that you will not have to put in that 60 hour. You will put in that 60 hour, but the output would be more. Okay. And for example, what you do, कि आपने एक टॉपिक पढ़ा, आपने घर जाके उसको पावर पॉइंट प्रेजेंटेशन से पढ़ा, व्हाटएवर एक्स्ट्रा पॉइंट्स यू फाइंड यू पुट इट इन योर नोट्स. नाउ आई टेल यू प्रैक्टिकल थिंग. फॉर एग्जांपल, देन यू सपोज यू आर हैविंग द मिनी टेस्ट एटसेट्रा, राइट, जिसमें आपके एमसीक्यूज होते हैं, राइट. इन दीज एमसीक्यूज यू विल फाइंड सर्टेन फैक्ट्स विच आर इन एडिशन टू व्हाट वी हैव डन इन द क्लास. सो यू पुट देम ऑल्सो इन योर नोट्स. यू हैव टू डू दैट वर्क. The class cannot become merely a dictation exercise where we are only doing facts. Because if that happens, then class will miss out on analysis. And without analysis, to aapka waise nahi hoga selection. Right? So, you have to do a bit of work ki aapko jo MCQ wale papers mil rahe hain, usko aap dekhiye, diligently kariye. Uske, usme se jo aapko additional facts mil rahe hain, usko apne, usme notes mein incorporate kariye. For example, I'm telling you, suppose you're reading पॉलिटी, आपने क्लास में पढ़ा है दैट फिनेंस कमीशन, पावर्स ऑफ फिनेंस कमीशन एटसेट्रा, राइट. इफ आर्टिकल कम्स टुमारो इन द न्यूज़पेपर ऑन फिनेंस कमीशन, देन यू शुड रीड दैट आर्टिकल. व्हेन यू रीड दैट आर्टिकल, टेक इट्स पॉइंट्स, एक्स्ट्रा पॉइंट्स, रेलिवेंट पॉइंट्स, राइट ऑन अ शीट ऑफ पेपर एंड पुट इट इन योर नोट्स वेर यू आर हैविंग फिनेंस कमीशन. दैट इज हाउ, सपोज यू रीडिंग एम्प्लॉयमेंट, सपोज यू रीड इन इकोनॉमी एम्प्लॉयमेंट issues in employment etcetera, ye aapne class mein padha. In the newspaper there comes an article on skill development and employment. You read that article, so aapne us article ko padha, you underline what are the key points, you take out of it, write on a sheet of paper and attach to your notes where you have written employment. So the, if you're coming to the class, understand the class can only lay a foundation, and the broader the better it is, and then you pick up things here and there, thoda thoda thoda, and keep joining it. Okay? Do not expect from anyone, I'm telling you, even if people are saying so, it's not possible, I don't think so it's possible, that in the class that one can do anything, everything under the sun, because that is simply not possible. And also the exam is always comparative, it is not absolute. You really don't need to know everything, you just need to know more than the others, that's it. Okay, so never there is a need to get very disheartened ki agar aapko nahi aa raha, so you should first ask yourself a question ki agar aapko nahi aa raha, is it something that is a way bouncer that you've never heard of? If you have prepared decently well and you've never heard about it, then quite much is the possibility that somebody else has also not heard about it. For example, history comes a question, who was one of the famous travelers who basically wrote about diamonds in India? Are aapko nahi pata to kisi ko nahi pata. That is not the question which is the differentiator question. But if the question comes on Government of India Act 1935 and you don't know, means it's a problem. Students have this habit of cribbing ki are wo to padhaya hi nahi, are jo padhaya tha wo hi to karna tha, wo to karate. You often focus in exams on things McBride commission. Sir, McBride commission to aapne padhaya hi nahi. Ha nahi padhaya, jo baki kar rahe the. कट ऑफ कितना जा रहा है, 50% भी नहीं जाता, राइट. टॉपर का, यूपीएससी टॉपर का मेंस एग्जाम में 50% नंबर आता है, राइट. दैट इज फॉर द रीजन दैट पीपल ऑलवेज कीप एंडलेसली वेस्टिंग द टाइम. अरे ये क्वेश्चन इस जगह से आया था तो ये पूरा पढ़ते हैं. अब द आउटकम इज समथिंग विच इज कंपेरेटिव. यूज टू बी दैट स्टोरी, राइट, दैट इफ टू फ्रेंड्स आर वॉकिंग इन द जंगल एंड यू नो देयर इज अ टाइगर कमिंग, You just need to be, you need to be faster than the tiger. You just need to be faster than your friend. That's it. Right. So ultimately, it's all, that is what that matters. आप लगे हैं कि नहीं सर एक जगह से मुझे सब पढ़ देना है, ऐसी कोई जगह होता है, ऐसी कोई जगह नहीं है. और उसके चक्कर में मत भागिए. Ensure that what you're doing in the class, complementing with the handouts, complementing with your test papers, etc. and the past 5 years paper is more than enough. अगर इसमें से नहीं आता है, और I'm be rest assured, ऐसे सवाल आएंगे जो इसमें से भी नहीं होंगे हर साल. But those questions are not the deciders. The deciders are those questions which you read, the topics you read, the questions you read, and you committed mistakes. That is what will decide. Rather than harping on कि नहीं सर, हमें को तो पूरा ही पढ़ना है. तो पूरा पढ़ने के लिए आपको एक साल में नहीं हो पाएगा, फिर वो कुछ और साल लगेंगे उसमें. और फिर भी whatever you read, unless and until you're revising, there's no point. Right. So please keep in mind, conciseness, revision is more important. Focusing on core areas is more important. Rather than banging your head on one or two fringe questions, they may have come from somewhere. Okay. And ये हमेशा का habit है उनका कि एक आध question medieval India से ऐसा डालेंगे कि आपने नहीं कभी सुना है. और या एक आध question, for example, they ask that वो मजदूर संघ पे, there was a question this year, right? 1948 organization. कौन थे फाउंडर है? ऑर्गेनाइजेशन का नाम नहीं सुना है किसी ने. वो कौन उसका फाउंडर है क्या पता. सो इफ दैट काइंड ऑफ अ क्वेश्चन कम्स, इट्स ओके, देयर इज नो प्रॉब्लम. बट इफ द क्वेश्चन कम्स व्हिच ऑफ द फॉलोइंग ऑर्गेनाइजेशन इज नॉट फॉर्मड बाय अंबेडकर एंड यू डोंट नो, मींस देयर इज अ प्रॉब्लम. क्योंकि अंबेडकर का बनाया हुआ ऑर्गेनाइजेशन आपको पता होना चाहिए, गांधी का बनाया हुआ ऑर्गेनाइजेशन आपको पता होना चाहिए. देयर सम रैंडम ऑर्गेनाइजेशन, नोबडी हैज हर्ड अबाउट इट, आपको भी नहीं पता तो कोई बात नहीं. Right, so this is your approach should be, do not have unrealistic expectation. कोई तो कारण होगा कि 200 में से 100 ही कट ऑफ जा रही है. Right, वो कारण यही है कि आप वहां दिमाग ना लगाएं, जहां लगाना है दिमाग वहां लगाएं. कि आपको ये पता होना चाहिए, इसमें कोई डाउट नहीं होना चाहिए कि फाइनेंस कमीशन को कौन अपॉइंट करता है, क्या पावर है, क्या टर्म है, कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनल बॉडी है कि नहीं. अब आपको ये नहीं पता कि NSSO 74th राउंड ऑफ डेटा क्या कह रहा है, तो वो किसी को नहीं पता ना. दैट इज नॉट द क्वेश्चन टू वरी अबाउट. बट पीपल एंड फर्स्ट टाइमर्स ऑफन बैंग देयर हेड ऑन दिस कि नहीं सर हमने ही मारने छक्के. राइट, सो दैट इज इट. स्किल ऑफ आंसर राइटिंग, वी डिड नॉट टॉक अबाउट आंसर राइटिंग. We did, right? वो इतनी स्किल अभी थोड़ा और बाद में. बिकॉज देखिए आंसर राइटिंग, द मोर यू डू, द फर्स्ट आंसर विल नेवर बी द परफेक्ट आंसर, द टेंथ आंसर विल नेवर बी द परफेक्ट आंसर. यू कीप राइटिंग, द मोर यू राइट द मोर यू विल इम्प्रूव. एंड वंस यू डन द टॉपिक, एक बार क्लास में जाइए पढ़िए, एक आर बार और पढ़िए, एटलीस्ट रीड टू टाइम्स एंड देन राइट द आंसर. डोंट राइट इट आफ्टर रीडिंग वंस. और आज आप क्लास से गए, अच्छा आपने क्वेश्चन, अच्छा आप इसको उठाते हैं और लिखना चालू करते, ऐसे नहीं करना. डोंट डू लाइक दिस. ओके, टेक द क्वेश्चन ओनली आफ्टर यू हैव रेड ट्वाइस एटलीस्ट, देन ओनली यू शुड ट्राई एंड राइट. ऑल्सो इन वन थिंग दैट आई हैव बीन सेइंग, लॉट ऑफ पीपल हु हैज बीन शोइंग मी देयर आंसर्स, इज दैट व्हेन यू राइटिंग आंसर्स, अपार्ट फ्रॉम कीपिंग द इंट्रोडक्शन ब्रीफ, राइटिंग द बॉडी मोर एंड फोकसिंग ऑल्सो ऑन द कंक्लूजन, ब्रेकिंग योर आंसर ऑल्सो इन स्मॉलर पैराग्राफ्स, दैट इज देयर. बट अपार्ट फ्रॉम दिस ऑल्सो, वेन एवर यू आर मेकिंग अ पॉइंट, use an example, use names and dates to substantiate that point. It should not happen that I ask you the causes of decline of Mughal Empire. You say there are bitter succession disputes within the Mughal Empire. That was one point and you elaborated. But if you are elaborating, you should give evidence. What was the succession dispute? That, for example, the succession dispute was over over Farrukh Siyar or over Muhammad Shah. Or there was dispute between different political factions in the Mughal court. So you again use the example of how the Sayyid brothers get assassinated by Asif Jahanwan, right? So you have to put in names, dates as examples to substantiate a point. History ke answer mein ye nahi ho sakta ki name ya date na ho. But history ka answer is not merely name and date. Both the things are there, okay? That is there. Now let's quickly firstly talk about reformists and revivalists. And firstly about नाउ आपको लिखने का कोई जरूरत नहीं है, बस सुनिए अभी, है ना। We are firstly talking about an organization by the name of Brahmo Samaj. Brahmo Samaj, we are taking it as an example to organ or to understand the nature of some of the organizations in 19th century India. Now, basic facts everybody has heard about that Brahmo Samaj is formed in 1828 by Ram Mohan Roy. This is an organization primarily based in, to begin with, in Bengal. And Brahmo Samaj was a typical organization, one of the early reformist organizations. And this organization established by Ram Mohan Roy and others who have done a good amount of what? Western education. Some of the early social reformers in India had studied in West, primarily in Britain, for varying periods of time, for a couple of years to graduations, etc. Higher education, a number of them had done in the West. And देखिए higher education का दिमाग पे अगर ढंग की जगह से मिले तो अच्छा प्रभाव पड़ता है। So basically, it is there that with their experiences of higher education in Western countries, they were getting influenced to the political and social developments in Europe. And when they looked at the political and social developments in Europe, studying European history, political and social developments there, they often drew some of their inspiration from there. For example, they studied European history, hum bhi padhenge world history, to wahan pe hum padhenge that if you actually look during the 1400s, 1500s, you know, this period of Europe where the Dark Age is ending, you know, or from 1400s and 1500s, where they say that the Dark Age is ending. Dark Age matlab age of no reason. India is currently in Dark Age. We have entered Dark Age. It's not that we were always dark, but we have entered Dark Age. But when you come out of Dark Age, kaise? Enlightenment. Enlightenment is also, so that is why this era is the Enlightenment era. The period from 1400s, 1500s in Europe is termed as the Enlightenment era. Why? Because they were coming out of the Dark Age where everything was dominated by the monarchy and the church. And the church. Okay? The church in Europe often had an explanation for everything that was happening in the society. So church said, why are you getting disease? Because it is a reason, it is the result of your sins. You have committed sins in the past, so you have disease. Hamare bhi kehte leprosy. राइट आपने पिछले जन्म में कुछ कर्म किए होंगे राइट सो बाय दैट मेजर आर पॉलिटिशियंस वुड हैव बीन हैविंग उन्होंने कौन से कर्म किए हमें भी वही करने राइट सो दे हैड एक्सप्लेनेशंस फॉर अ नंबर ऑफ बायोलॉजिकल फिनोमेना बट देन केम साइंस एंड साइंटिफिक डेवलपमेंट्स क्वेश्चन दिस फॉर एग्जाम्पल दिस रॉबर्ट कॉच गेव द जर्म थ्योरी ऑफ डिजीज And in the germ theory of disease, Koch is saying that people develop diseases not because of any joint past sin or etc., but because of microorganisms. Okay. Then, for example, why does apple fall down on earth? The church has no explanation for this. The church says that it is God's wish. Newton is saying that it is G is equal to m1 m2 upon r square. Okay, that he is saying that gravitation explains why objects fall to earth. If God's wish it is, then God's wish is explained according to this formula. We have uncovered what is God's wish. Then the church said that God has created life on earth, and that is why earth is at the center of the universe. Dekh, ekdam sahi logic hai. God has created life on earth, not there on any other planet. So earth has to be at the center of the universe. Okay, so. But then Copernicus gave the model, Kepler, Copernicus, all these people are saying that it's probably not Earth is not at the center, it is the Sun, the heliocentric model of the universe. The church gave the geocentric model of the universe. Now, Galileo then is inventing the telescope, and the telescope proves that the theory of Copernicus is right. Then the church puts Galileo under prison. So, aise hota hai. This is the age of darkness, right? So, aap darkness mein light throw karenge, to aap bhi हो जाएंगे, है ना. सो दिस इज समथिंग दैट इज हैपनिंग विद गैलीलियो. सो नंबर ऑफ दीज साइंटिफिक डेवलपमेंट्स वर डायरेक्टली और इनडायरेक्टली क्वेश्चनिंग हूज एक्सप्लेनेशन, द एक्सप्लेनेशन ऑफ द चर्च. द चर्च वाज आल्सो एज एन एक्सप्लेनेशन फॉर द रूल ऑफ द किंग्स, दैट इट इज आल्सो व्हाट गॉड्स विश, that it is God's wish that the monarchs are ruling Europe. So just like there were a number of scientific developments which questioned the legitimacy of the church or the explanations of the church, they indirectly said that it need not be that whatever is being said by the church is bound to be true. It could be questioned. It could be subjected to a reason, to a analysis based on reason. Whatever is found illogical, whatever is found to be an illogical explanation supported by the church, that need not be necessarily believed or blindly followed. So that is why they are arguing that a number of these scientific advancements are indirectly doing what? Questioning the hold of the church or questioning certain religious ideas and belief. For example, Galileo himself said, I am a devout Christian. He never said that I am not, I am an earth atheist or anything. Firstly, it's a dangerous thing to say. Anyways, but Galileo never said this. Galileo said, I'm a devout Christian. So did Newton. But they're saying that basically, not everything that the church is saying needs to be necessarily believed in. Partly their actions are questioning the legitimacy of the beliefs, practices supported by the church. Ab in sab ke bare mein hamare deshvasi bahar jaake padh rahe. So they're saying that we can also learn from them. And they are also getting influenced by other political and social developments. For example, France and Britain were some of the first countries to do what? To abolish slavery. Britain and France were some of the first countries to abolish slavery. Slavery is the worst form of social inequality. So they said, ki are, wahan bhi to social equality, there are developments in Europe which are happening in direction of social equality. Why can't we have the same in India? In Western society, they are saying that women must be better educated, better fed. So they are saying, why can't our Indian women can be better educated and better fed? So they are taking a number of inspirations from the scientific, the political, and the social developments in the West and are using that the same principles which have guided these developments must be applied to Indian societies. What are these principles? They are saying that these principles are what? These principles, they are saying are what? That these principles are the principles of reason, of equality, of humanism and universalism. So we are saying that all, whether blacks or whites, everybody must be treated equally. There must be no slavery. That is based on the principle that we are all equal. Every belief propagated by the church need not be blindly followed. It can be subjected to an analysis based on reasoning and the spirit of questioning. You can question the ideas propagated by the church. So that is on the spirit of reason. What about humanism and universalism? The fact that we all are Universalism is in the sense, for example, in India, the parallel of this is very easy to explain, Vasudev Kutumbakam, that we all are a part of one fraternity. We all are a part of one broader family. So, and also if we are a part of one broader family, we must acquire a more humanistic attitude towards other people, other societies, other regions, etc. also. So they're saying that all these egalitarian ideas which brought about so many political, scientific and social developments in the West must also be used to examine the practices in India. And here they focused on three things. One is the issue of caste. Other is the issue of women. And the third is the issue of religious beliefs. Sabse बेसिक सिंपल चीज से चालू करते हैं, रिलीजियस बिलीफ्स. ओके, डेंजरस काम है ये आजकल, है ना. सो इफ राम मोहन रॉय वुड हैव बीन टुडे, अभी आपको पता चल जाएगा इनकी लाइफ एक्सपेक्टेंसी और ही कम होती, राइट. सो whatever I am saying next in the 5 minutes, I claim no legitimacy for making these statements. Please do not attack me and don't get offended. So what they are saying is that Hinduism needs to be reformed in the light of rationality and reason. And a reform of Hinduism in the light of rationality and reason, firstly, has to do away with certain practices. What are these practices? Firstly, do away with idolatry or the worshipping of idols. And they give the explanations also. I'll tell you that explanations also. Secondly, they said do away with polytheism. Thirdly, they said that do away with idolatry, do away with polytheism, do away with the hold of priestly class on Indian society. Do away with the hold of priestly class on the Indian society. Okay. आप चाहें तो एक पेज पे ये सब लिख भी सकते हैं, बस एक एक शब्द लिख लीजिए. शब्दों से क्या होता है, हमेशा आप देखिए, आपको एक इंटरेस्टिंग मैं बताता हूं. ये इट्स अ बेसिक ऑफ हाउ टू रीड फास्ट. एक्चुअली अ नंबर ऑफ स्टडीज इन कॉग्निटिव साइकोलॉजी हैव शोन दैट यू नेवर रीड द होल पैरा और द सेंटेंस, यू ओनली पिक अप कीवर्ड्स. वो कीवर्ड ही आपका दिमाग पढ़ता है, बाकी सब वो अपने आप भर देता है उसमें. Okay, especially when you are familiar with the topic. If you are not familiar, तो आप सब पढ़ेंगे धीमे धीमे धीमे. जहां आपने दो तीन बार पढ़ लिया, then your brain only picks up keywords. For example, if you give me an article to read, you also read. You will take 10 minutes, I'll only look for 2 minutes. It will not take me more than 2 minutes to read editorial. It doesn't take. क्योंकि I know कि उसमें क्या लिखा है. I'm just looking for क्या नया लिखा है. क्योंकि मैं तो 10 साल से पढ़ रहा हूं, आपने अभी चालू किया तो आपको 15 मिनट लगेगा. इट विल टेक मी 2 मिनट्स. सो इट आल्सो हैपन विद यू. इफ यू स्टार्ट रीडिंग न्यूज़पेपर टुडे, 3 मंथ्स अगर इट्स टेकिंग यू 3 आवर्स राइट नाउ, 4 मंथ्स डाउन द लाइन यू विल रिड्यूस इट टू 1.5 आवर्स. सो बेसिकली व्हाट कीवर्ड्स डू इज, हाँ, रीजन, इक्वालिटी, ह्यूमनिज्म, यूनिवर्सलिज्म, रिलीजियस बिलीव्स आर क्वेश्चन्ड, आइडियोलेट्री, पॉलिथिज्म, रोल ऑफ प्रीस्टली क्लास. तो यही आपको अल्टीमेटली याद जो रहेगा वो यही रहेगा. And then you will write it in sentences. So, what is idolatry? Basically, the practice of worshipping idols, right? Now, basically, they're saying that where is the proof that God exists in anthropomorphic forms? Basically, they're studying a number of religions across the world, okay? And they're saying that there are remarkable similarities in religions across the world. One similarity is that gods or messengers of God or sons of God, firstly, they look like all humans. And the second similarity is, it's not just that they look like humans, they are also males. You have Christ, you have Prophet, you have the Trinity of Gods in Hinduism, Brahma, Vishnu, Mahesh. All of them are males, or the sons are messenger of God, all are males, right? So they said, one is the similarity. How come gods only look like humans? Okay, where is the reason to believe that? So they said that even if there is God, God perhaps does not have a, you know, it's, you know, or God does not, need not look like humans. There is no reason to believe that. So it is an irrational belief to believe not in God. It's irrational to believe that gods look like humans, or they take forms similar to your imagination. Okay. Secondly, for example, if you look at Hanuman also, you see, Hanuman also in many popular depictions today has acquired 6 packs. Right? Or you have Amish Tripathi's books. Right? So, wo kahan mythology, kahan religious belief, kahan fiction, kaun kisse kab kahan mil raha hai, kuch nahi pata chalta. Right? So, that evokes a kind of a imagery which they're saying is not very rational to believe in. Okay? Secondly, that they're saying is polytheism, the practice that you believe, the idea that you believe that there is a God for Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. separate gods for every day. There's nothing like this. There's no parliament of gods sitting up there. Right? The fact is that if there is a creator, there is only one creator. And if there is only one creator, then there is no logic to believe in multiple gods. And they argue that it's not just in Hinduism that there are multiple gods. A number of ancient Greek religions, etc., they also believe there's a sun god, winter god, you know, etc. So many gods. Why? Because if there are many gods, there are many gods to be pleased. If many gods have to be pleased, there are many rituals. And if there are more rituals, there is more hold of the priestly class. Another thing that they said was that one of the things remarkable about world religions is that most of them are written in a language that people do not understand. For example, if you look at Hindu religious texts, some of them are written either in Sanskrit or in Prakrit, languages that most people never understood. Aapko bhi nahi aati hogi, mostly. Right. But Prime Minister says it can help tackle climate change also. Okay. So, वो कोई बात नहीं अभी उस पर भी आएंगे. So, that is there. Huh? So, we'll come to this. This is what they're suggesting. That they're not, their argument is never that religion has to be discarded. Nowhere are the Brahmo Samaj saying that religion has to be discarded. Rather, they are saying that religion has to be reformed. You do away with idolatry, you do away with polytheism, you do away with the hold of priestly class. Why? Because, and one of the reasons why priestly class has a hold on society, because religious texts are written in a language that people barely understand. So, for example, in Hinduism you have Sanskrit Prakrit, for example, in Islam you may have it in either in the Arabic text, which very few people understood, or in Christianity you may have it in Hebrew or either Latin to begin with, the Old Testament, Testament, etc., which very few people understood. So these texts are written in a language that people barely understood, leaving little scope for them to read it on their own and make their own interpretations, which is not, and they have to follow what the priest says written in the book. So what do? Is you allow more individualistic interpretation of religion. How? By converting texts into vernacular or local languages. By translating these religious texts into vernacular and local languages, you translate them and give it to people. People can then read religious texts on their own and make their own individualistic interpretation, not depending on priests to tell them what is to be done and what are the do's and don'ts. And also, individualistic interpretation does not mean that they will follow religion or religious text word by word. Individualistic interpretation ka matlab hi yahi hai, that they will read, interpret, and if they find something relevant, they will do it. If they don't find it relevant, they may not do it. So you may have a Hindu who may read all Hindu religious texts, etc., and then come to the conclusion that I'll eat non-veg and I'll still read Sanskrit texts. That is my interpretation. Nobody has a right to tell me what to do or what not to do, or which aspect of religion is the core religious aspect. If I want to practice certain aspects of religion, I will practice. I want to celebrate Holi, I'll celebrate. I don't want to, I won't. I want to celebrate Diwali, I'll celebrate. I don't want to, I don't want to. I want to. So whatever is the interpretation an individual makes with his application of his own mind, and that is how they will practice religion also. This is what they're saying. And then Ram Mohan Roy is also actually goes a step ahead and says, yeah, I'll mix. He's like Akbar, like mix elements of different religion and make new religion. So he's like, he'll study all religions, then take the relevant and the worthy aspects of all religions, mix them together and form a new religion only. That is going a bit too far. Okay, but that is not, and we'll talk about that later. But this is one thing that Ram Mohan Roy talks about. Now, this is, what are they saying? That this needs to be done. Or a conversion of religious texts into vernacular languages. But please remember, they are not saying anything about not following religion or abolition of religion. Because aisi baat waise bhi karna sehat ke liye hanikarak hai. So they are just talking about reform of religion. बट ऑल ऑफ दिस इज ऑल्सो टू मच. ये कह रहे हैं कि आप ये सब मत करिए, सो दिस इज ऑल्सो. आप आज के टाइम में ऐसा कोई ढूंढ के बता दीजिए जो ये कह दे. ये इसलिए हम भी सो इट रिमाइंड्स मी स्पिरिचुअलिटी टुडे लव्स कैपिटलिज्म. They have a very cozy relationship. You find no Baba. Babas today can come on Harley Davidson and still talk to you about spirituality. And if you would have a Buddha, Buddha would turn in his grave, dig it 2 feet deeper and go inside. Because if spirituality often has been something that has talked about an atheistic or an ascetic lifestyle rather than basically aap to matlab, so that is why people like Osho were a very different exceptional individuals, but he never claimed to be having some higher whatever wisdom etc. So, lekin abhi aajkal kya hai ki baba aapko batayenge kaise. Babas today have answers for everything, from what you should eat to why democracy is good to why spirituality is also good and why they can have thousands of acres of land. Because that is also spiritual. And वो Harley Davidson पे भी आएंगे, वो climate change के बारे में भी बात कर लेंगे. It's okay. It's your viewpoint. It's my viewpoint. We can have different viewpoints. It's okay. But my viewpoint is this. Okay. And so ठीक है, वो सब सही है. वही so वो तो चलिए कहीं लिखा भी हो तो कोई जरूरी नहीं आपको कुछ follow करना. I don't think so. Even if it's written somewhere. You need not. You can always make your. So we are all for individualistic interpretation. Make your interpretation. Do whatever. So women. Now coming to the issue of women, there were two things. Coming to the issue of women, there were two things, and they said that on the issue of women, they are saying two things. Firstly, what? We need women who are better educated, better. Fed, and that is why firstly women who are better educated and better fed, so they were against what? Child marriage, they were against child marriage, they supported increasing the minimum age of marriage. And also against child marriage, increasing the minimum age of marriage, and also what? That apart from these things, they talked about women's education or promotion of women education also. So these are the things, because again they're getting inspired partly from the West and the developments in the West, because many ideas in the West talked about these things, increasing the age of marriage or promoting women education etc. Now it is in this context that yeah, 1828, okay, so it is all happening in 1800s. In the early 1800s, in the first half of the 1800s, the 19th century, all these things were talked about. What about caste? About the issue of caste, they said that we are for abolition of untouchability. Okay, and they also, for example, supported the abolition of sati. Right, we've already talked about this. Right, they're also for the abolition of untouchability. Now, firstly, understand, they're saying that why should you promote women education, minimum age of marriage, etc. The reasoning for this that they gave was a better educated and a better fed woman can be a better mother, a better wife, and can contribute to the society better. against abolition of sati, they said there is no major Hindu religious text which supports the practice of sati except for a few texts here and there, and they can be ignored. No major Indian religious text actually supports the practice of sati, and so there is not even a very strong religious justification for practices like sati within the Hindu religious texts, and so they are best done away with. Okay, because they are saying that reform of the religion must happen in the light of rationality and equality. What is the rationale or the notion of supporting the practice of sati? They are saying there is no rational also, and there is no strong religious support also for these practices. Then what about caste? They are saying that on the issue of caste, they are for the abolition of untouchability. Talking about the abolition of untouchability, they are making a point here. What is that point? That on abolition of untouchability, they are saying that we are not for the abolition of caste system in totality, but only for the abolition of untouchability. So, and why is that? That I'll explain later. But what is the difference? Pehli baat to aapko yahi pata hona chahiye, kai logon ko yahi nahi pata hai. And it's a very common misconception that we have. That who are untouchables? Okay, so who are untouchables according to the caste system? Just giving a very basic thing for now is that you have the Shudras, and then so basically these are the four different varnas or the broad caste groups. Broad is can the sub caste be? But these are the four different broad caste groups: the Brahmins, the warrior class, that is the Kshatriyas, the merchants, the Vaishyas, and the Shudras, all other manual skilled laborers. They do not have one common occupation, but a variety of heterogeneous, different skilled, manual skilled laborers. They could be whom? They could be, for example, the gardeners. They could be sculptors. They could be locksmiths, kuch bhi ho sakte, okay, but they're doing manual skill labor. So who are the untouchables? The Shudras are not the untouchables. That is why they are actually, the untouchables are outside this fourfold varna system. They are not a part of this varna system. They are outside this fourfold varna system, because in this fourfold varna system, they are considered to be derived from right head, chest, thighs, and feet, right, from different parts of the mythical individual, whatever, right. So from, but where are the untouchables? Untouchables are not, wo pata nahi kahan se hai. Basically they are not a part of this system. Okay, and so given that they are not a part of the system, they cannot obtain any services, or they cannot interact with the upper caste groups. They cannot interact with any of the castes, nor can they obtain any of their services. Rather, they are only to, for what purpose? They are only meant for clearing of sewage, human excreta, or clearing of waste. Okay, so basically they are not in these four varnas. They do not live in the same villages. They live outside the villages. They would not live in the same villages. They would not allowed to draw water from the same wells, or come even in touch, or probably in some areas even in the sight of other caste groups. Okay, even if the shadow of a untouchable was to fall on upper caste individual, he would become impure, and then he would have to do rituals, etc. So the untouchables were considered outside the caste system, faced the worst form of discrimination, and thus there was a need to, and they faced the worst form of discrimination, what you know today as Dalits or they are the untouchables. Okay, and what you see broadly as OBCs come from a subset of the Shudra, groups. Okay, so OBCs and Dalits unke beech mein ye difference hai. Okay, and that is, and the OBC category is a, again, a broader category which includes various castes from the Shudra group or subcastes from the Shudra group. Not all Shudras are OBCs, but OBCs are predominantly Shudras. Okay, and the Dalits or the scheduled castes are different. Now, why am I telling you this? Is because they argued that untouchability is like slavery. Untouchability is like slavery because slave has no rights, has nothing of, and slave has no rights, no income, nothing. He owns no property. He absolutely has no right to exist. He is just like property which can be bought and sold in the market. So similarly, just like the position of slaves is poor, so is the position of untouchable. Just like the West has abolished untouchability, sorry, slavery, we should abolish untouchability. These are some of the ideas that are talked by the Brahmo Samaj. There are other things also that we'll talk later. Adi Brahmo Samaj, Sadharan Brahmo Samaj, all these things later. Clear? We'll stop here. In the next class, we'll continue from there. Thank you.
Yeah.